Good afternoon, everyone. Let me start the program. Hello?
Okay, you can start.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. In the name of God, let us start today's webinar. First of all, I invite Reverend Father Shano Monieli, Assistant Director, Lucy Hospital, for the inaugural address. Father? Father?
Yes, hello.
Hello. Father, let's start today's webinar by the inaugural session.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. Respected fathers, respected Dr. Shiga, today's speaker, Dr. Shabir, principals from different colleges, faculty members, professionals, and students. It's my privilege to be part of this webinar series, Excellencia, and to inaugurate this section. First of all, on behalf of LISI Medical and Education Institution, I appreciate LISI College of Allied Health Sciences, especially Dr. Shabir and the faculty members who took initiative to bring this webinar series successful. I think the topic selected for today's section is most relevant because we are on the way to fight against the pandemic situation. Safety in the clinical laboratories is one of the most important pillars in laboratory procedure and medical practice. Report says India is between the stage 2 and 3 of COVID-19 pandemic. At this juncture, precautions should be taken while handling the specimens that are suspected or confirmed for COVID-19 in the clinical laboratories to minimize the risk of infection transmission. It involves safety practices followed by laboratory staff during phlebotomy, sample processing, and proper disposal of waste. Timely communication between clinical and laboratory staff is essential when lab investigations are requested for a suspected or confirmed case of COVID-19. Such specimens should be labeled accordingly and laboratory staff should be alerted to ensure proper specimen handling. Today, we have the right person to enlighten on laboratory safety precautions and sample handling. I wish all the very best to Dr. Shiga and declare day 3 Excellencia webinar series as inaugurated. Wish you all a fruitful time. Thank you.
Thank you, Father. Let's start the webinar series. Myself, Jyotishna Dasan, Assistant Professor, LISI College of Allied Health Sciences. It's been an honor to have given a chance to introduce the chief guest of today's webinar series. I am very proud and happy today to introduce Dr. Shikha T, who has agreed to present a class for all of us on the topic Laboratory Safety Precautions and Sample Handling. I knew her for the last 7 to 8 years. She has stood as my teacher, mentor, and as my project guide during my post-graduation. Dr. Shikha T is now working in the Department of Pathology, Jawaharlal Institute of Postgraduate Medical Education and Research, JIPMER, Puducherry. She has completed her BSc MLT and MSc MLT from Calicut University, Center for Health Sciences, and Doctor of Philosophy focused in microbiology from Indian Council of Medical Research, Port Blair, under Pondicherry University. She has worked as lecturer and technologist at School of Health Sciences, Talisheri, and Government Institute of Paramedical Sciences,
Payyanur respectively. Respected ma'am, thank you so much for being with us today. Without further ado, on behalf of entire GC family, I welcome you to the excited online audience. Dr. Shikhati, Department of Pathology, Puducherry. Welcome, ma'am.
Hello.
A very good afternoon to you all. First of all, I am giving my thankful to EC team for giving me this opportunity. Now we can start.
Okay, ma'am.
We can start the session.
Screen sharing started.
We can start the screen sharing.
Hello.
Hello, can we start our screen sharing?
Admin allowed.
Yeah. You can start, Shiga.
Okay.
You're disabled on that.
Now also it is disabled.
Hello, Shiga. Dr. Shiga, can you?
Okay, now.
Okay.
Okay, let us start. COVID-19 laboratory safety precautions and sample handling. A small introduction. Coronavirus disease is a potentially severe acute respiratory infection caused by SARS-CoV-2, and the virus was identified as the causative agent of pneumonia of unknown origin in Wuhan City, China. The clinical presentation is that of a respiratory infection with severity ranging from a mild common cold-like illness to severe viral pneumonia leading to acute respiratory distress syndrome that is potentially fatal. Then transmission of infection through person to person, through droplets and contact transmissions. When the droplet particles are greater than 5 to 10 micrometer in diameter, they are referred to as respiratory droplets. And when they are less than 5 micrometer in diameter, they are referred to as a droplet nuclei. Transmission may also occur through fomites in the immediate environment around the infected person, and also infection may lead to intestinal infection and be present in feces. Now, prevention. Hand hygiene is an important method of prevention. And at what time we want to wash our hands? Before and after touching a patient, we want to wash our hands. And before doing a procedure, we want to wash our hands. And after touching,
hello, Dr. Shiga, please wait one second. Hello, Shiga, can you hear me? Hello, Shiga, can you hear me? Hello, Shiga. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Hello.
Okay. You carry on. Carry on.
Can I continue?
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Hello.
Hello. Is any problem? Network problem is there?
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Then when we want to wash our hands, wash your hands with soap and water, running tap water when the hands are visibly dirty. If your hands are not visibly dirty, frequently clean them by using alcohol-based hand rub or soap and water. Then the steps of hand washing. First, apply or wet your hands with hand wash. Then, these all steps I think you all know. Then step 2, palm to palm rubbing. Then step 3, back to palm. Then step 4, interface of the fingers. Next is back of finger on palms. And the 6th step is thumb, rotating both the sides of the both thumbs. Then scrub your nails on palms. And finally, rinse hands with water, dry with single-use paper towel, then close the tap with same paper towel or elbow, if there is elbow handle for the pipe. Then, how to protect yourself and others from getting sick? Thoroughly wash your hands. When you want to wash, after coughing or sneezing, you want to wash your hands. When caring for a sick patient, you wash your hands. Before and during, after you prepare a food, you wash your hands. Before eating also and after using toilet, you wash your hands. When hands are visibly dirty, you wash your hands. After handling animal waste or animals, you wash your hands thoroughly with soap and water. And how to protect the others from getting sick? When coughing or sneezing, cover the mouth and nose with flexed elbow or tissue. Throw the tissue into a closed bin immediately after use. Don't throw the tissue here and there. Clean the hands with alcohol-based hand rub or soap and water after coughing or sneezing and when caring for a sick patient. And nowadays, do not give shake hands to any person. Greet the people with a wave or a nod or a bow. We all are using gloves. Now I'm telling about the gloves ethics. Always wear gloves while handling a sample. Consider all of the samples is infectious. Blood, urine, stool, semen, body fluids, any sample which are coming in laboratory, all samples are infectious. Remove glove if any spillage or sample on glove. That means while we are capping or we are taking the sample from a bottle, if any spillage in your gloves, kindly remove that gloves and use a new gloves for further procedures. Don't keep wearing the same gloves for a long time. Wear a fresh gloves for the next activity. Do hand hygiene before and after use of gloves. It is not recommended not to hand hygiene over gloved hand. Always dispose in red bag after use. And how to wear a gloves? Take out the gloves from the original glove box. Then do not touch every part of the glove. Only limited area you should touch. Then carefully don the first glove. Then take the second glove with the bare hand and touch only restricted surface of the glove corresponding to the wrist. To avoid touching the skin of the forearm with gloved hand, turn the external surface of the glove to be donned on the folded fingers of the gloved hand, thus permitting to glove the second hand. Once gloved, do not touch anywhere. Only do the procedures. How to remove the gloves? This is also important because after using the glove is dirty. So, if you are touching here and there, infection will be transmitted. So, removal of gloves. Pinch one glove at the wrist level to remove it without touching the skin of the forearm and peel away the hand, thus allowing the glove to turn inside out. Then, hold the removed glove in the glove hand and side the fingers of the ungloved hand inside the glove, the second glove by rolling it down the hand and fold into first glove. Now the first glove will be inside the second glove, then discard it in the red bag. Next is the use of mask. We all know nowadays three types of mask are there. Cloth mask is there, surgical mask is there, and N95 mask is there. It is not recommended cloth mask in the hospital settings, because it in cloth mask it is not that much of protective against coronaviruses. Then is the surgical mask. It is recommended in the hospital settings, labs and all. And an N95 mask is used only when we are dealing with the COVID positive patients. And do not allow tangling of mask around the neck. This procedure we are all doing, but it is wrong. And touch only the strings of the mask. Do not touch front or back of the mask. And how to wear a mask. The first step is bring the mask into the face, placing the metal nose piece over the bridge of the nose to ensure close and comfortable fit. Next, secure the tying the top set of strings behind the head. Nose, then tie behind the head. Pull the bottom of the mask fit closely under the chin. Secure tying the bottom of set of strings high on the head above the first strip. That means first set of strings should be upper earlobe, and then second set should be above the first set be tied. Okay. Then how to remove the face mask? If you are having a glove, first remove the glove. After that only you have to remove your mask. Untie the strings and remove the mask handling only by the strings. Dispose the mask into waste bin, that means yellow bin. Glove should be disposed in red bag. Mask should be disposed in yellow bag. After this procedures, wash your hands. Now how to use N95 mask. It is having a nose slit located in the top panel. Perform the nose slit by gently bending at the center of the panel. Hold respirator into one hand and pull out bottom panel to the cup. Turn the respirator over to exposed headbands, then cup to the under chin and pull the strap over head. Okay. Then locate lower strap below the ears and upper strap to crown of the head. Use both hands, mold nose slit to the shape of the lower part of the nose. Pinching the nose piece using only one hand may result in less effective respiratory performance. The seal of the respirator on the face should be fit checked prior to wearing in the work area. Before you are going to deal with a COVID positive patient, kindly check the seal. Then how to check the fit checkup? Fit check for N95 respirators. Hospital care workers must perform fit checking every time they put on N95 respirator. Because if fit check is not proper, the respirator to ensure if it is properly fitted and functional. Placement. How to use this? The respirator is placed on the face and tied over the head and base of the neck. Sealing. The N95 mask is compressed to ensure a seal across the face, cheeks and the bridge of the nose. Positive pressure seal of N95 mask is set by gently exhaling. If air escapes, the N95 mask needs to be adjusted. Okay. The negative pressure seal of the N95 mask is set by gently inhaling. If the N95 mask is not drawn in towards the face or air leaks around the face seal, the N95 mask is readjusted and the process is repeated. And the first thing is removal of facial hair in mask fitting area is mandatory for better sealing in male. If still not proper, then respirator should be checked for any defect or damage. Next is the PPE. The first checklist of PPE, general points you should remove, you should note that. Remove white coat or extra clothing, watch, jewelry, personal items, mobiles, everything out. If you wear glasses, clean them. Wear after donning surgical or N95 mask. Drink enough water, use toilet before donning. Shave your beard, mask will not fit well otherwise. Trained observer will assist while wearing the PPE. And steps to use the coverall. First, inspect the PPE. check for any tears, check the size is matching to us. Like that, first you check the PPE or coverall, then do the head cap, then shoe covers. After that, hand rub, then put on your inner gloves, then coverall or gown. Sit properly and you wear your gown. After that, surgical or N95 mask you have to put, then goggles, then hood, and finally put the outer gloves, that means second gloves. Now, how to remove the PPE, that is doffing of PPE. This is very important because we are dealing with the patient. No, that time maybe the infectious material is with the coverall. So removing is very important. The first point is remove PPE slowly and carefully. A trained observer can check from 2 meters away. Remove the mask outside the patient care area. And how to doffing coverall. First inspect any tear or there. Then remove outer gloves. And the removal procedure is as I told you before, like that only you have to remove your gloves. Then put your coverall. After that, shoe covers. Then hand rub. Then goggles. Then surgical mask and head cap. After that, inner gloves. Then finally, hand wash. Okay. Now, what are the respiratory hygiene or respiratory cuff etiquette? Do not directly cuff or sneeze on hands. Use sleeve while cuffing. Wear surgical mask to limit the spread. Turn your head away from others and use tissue while cuffing or sneezing. Hand hygiene after cuffing or sneezing. Now, measures during mopping. Because cleaning of the lab also is very important. If you clean the lab in improper way, it itself may contaminate the entire area. Okay. Now, the cleaning sequence. Always clean should be proceeded in a top to down sequence. That is ceiling based equipment first, walls, then floor based equipment, and lastly the floor. When cleaning the floor, begin at the end farthest from the door side and move towards the door. That means cleaner area to dirtier area. The cleaning staff should always move from clean to unclean areas and never vice versa. While cleaning individual equipment, clean from top to down. Go from clean to unclean area and top to down. Number of strokes per wipe vary depends on area and material. Use new wipes for each use. That means should not use same wipes or towels for monitors, machines, everything. Use single things and discard each one. Never do zigzag cleaning. Do systematically. Not recommended re-dipping of the clothing. Now the segregation of biomedical waste and management. Blood, serum, we have to segregate in red bag and autoclave. And if you want, this blood or serum can be treated with the hypochlorite 1%, then discard the treated blood into the drainage, and the rest of the bottle you can discard into red bag. Then sterile fluid with container. Red bag, which should be double layered, it should go to autoclave, plastic container or red bag. Then blood culture bottles. It also put in red bag and it will go to autoclave. Swabs or wound swabs like that also in red bag. First tissues with aspirate, drain fluids and all autoclave. That also in red bag. And sputum and other respiratory specimens, first we have to treat it with 5% phenol. Then plastic container, red bag. Urine and stool, we can discard in 5% phenol and discard into drainage. Then viral transport media with swabs, treated with 1% hypochlorite for 30 minutes, then sent for autoclave. Nail clippings, skin, hair, that materials in yellow bag. Water samples for surveillance, discard into the drainage. Okay. Now, the spill management protocol. While we are handling the sample, maybe spillage may occur. If any spillage occurs, what we have to do first is confine the spill and wipe with absorbent cloth, spread over the spill into solidified the blood or disposed in yellow bag. If the spillage is a small spillage, or that means 1 or 2 drops of blood is there, use 1:100 dilution of 5% chlorine and allow it to 10 minutes and then wipe it off. If a large spill is there, use 1:10 dilution of 5% chlorine bleach and then allow it for 10 minutes to act, and finally rinse the item in water to remove the disinfectant residue. Okay, now the collection of sample. This is very important part. First of all, the clinician should decide necessity for collection of clinical sample for lab testing of 2019 novel coronavirus only after following the case definition as given by the health authorities of Government of India. Only trained healthcare worker trained should be perform the specimen collection in the presence of a clinician. And consider all the specimens are potentially hazardous or infectious. Place each specimen into a separate container, label with the patient's name, ID number, collection site, date of collection, and the time of collection. Do not handle laboratory requisition forms with contaminated gloves. Okay, that means all the requisition forms are collecting the sample. Personal protective equipment, that means apron, hand glove, face shield, N95 mask, etc. you should wear and need to be used, and all biosafety precautions should be followed while carrying out sample collection and packaging. Now, how to collect the sample? Essential samples are throat swab and nasal swab. We should collect throat swab and nasal swab of the same patient because we want a maximum number of viral load. Okay, and collect the sample within symptoms onset and preferably prior to initiation of antimicrobial chemo prophylaxis or therapy. Other preferred samples are bronchoalveolar lavage, tracheal aspirate, and sputum sample. And if a lab confirmed patient, that means COVID positive patient, we can collect blood, stool, and urine for presence of virus. And the collection and storage and transport details. Okay, they are collecting the nasal or nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal swab. It should be collected in Dacron or polyester cloth swabs. And the temperature should be 4 degrees Celsius. That means cold chain we have to maintain for the transportation of the swabs. And both the swabs, that means the nasal swab and the oropharyngeal swabs, both are put in the same container to increase the viral load. Okay. Now, bronchoalveolar lavage. It should be collected in the sterile container. That means all other fluid samples, means bronchoalveolar lavage, rectal aspirate, nasopharyngeal aspirate, sputum, and these all things, stool and urine, all should collect in a sterile container. And for the transportation to the lab, we want to maintain the cold chain. Okay. Then if tissue from biopsy or autopsy, including lung part, that should be transported with the saline. Okay, collected into a sterile container and add saline into it, then transport. Now the method of sample collection. Okay, place the patient in a well lighted room and stand directly in front of the patient. Place the patient in a comfortable sitting position facing the light source. Avoid touching the swab tip to any surface other than the tonsil area, because we want to take the sample from the both of the tonsils and back side of the tongue. Remove the swab from the container and hold the swab firmly by the handle. Do not place the swab on any surface once it is removed from the protective package. And instruct the patient to open mouth wide as possible. And instruct the patient to say, ah. That means the tongue should be outside. The tonsil area may be redundant, swollen or have white patches. The infected patients, both the tonsils may be red, and we can see some white patches there. And how to obtain the specimen? Direct the tip towards the tonsil area. The tip of the swab, you have to put in directly into the tonsil area. Do not touch the swab tip to any other area of the mouth, including the tongue. That means carefully you should insert the swab. Collect the throat swab samples by standard clinical methods. Depress the tongue with a tongue blade or spoon. Be careful not to touch the tongue, sides or the top of the mouth with the swab. Rub the swab on the back of the throat, on the tonsils, and in any other area where there is redness, inflammation or pus. That means do not collect the white patched area. Now obtaining a specimen. Touch the swab tip to the tonsil area. Rub the swab tip quickly and firmly over this area to obtain a good sample. Remove swab from mouth without touching any surface. A gag reflex reaction is very common when a good sample is obtained. It is recommended that the swab specimen be processed as soon as possible after collection. That means if it is stored for a long time, the efficiency of test will be altered. Now the package. This is also very important because from our part, we should not transmit the disease by our carelessness. Okay, so transport should be careful. Then how to transport? The sample should be safely packed in a triple container packing and should be transported under cold chain to the reference laboratory with prior intimation. That means we should inform the laboratory or wherever we are sending, we should inform. Because there also they have to receive the sample and they have to store or process the sample. For that, they also want to be some precautions. Like us, the person in the lab also should take care of the precautions. The packing consists of three layers as follows. First one is primary receptacle. A labeled primary watertight leak-proof receptacle containing the specimen. This receptacle is wrapped in enough absorbent material to absorb all fluid in case of a breakage. The second receptacle is watertight leak-proof receptacle to enclose and protect the primary receptacle. Several wrapped primary receptacles may be placed in one secondary receptacle. Sufficient additional absorbent material must be used to cushion multiple primary receptacles. Okay. Then the third one is the outer shipping package, that is cover. You can use a plastic container or use a cardboard box also. The secondary receptacle is placed in an outer shipping package which is protect it and contents from outside influences such as physical damage and water by in transit. This is a feature that first aid screw cap the board. After that, some things to, if any leakage is there, protect with some cushion like thing, then put it in a second tube, and third one is a cardboard. And it is very important that label the specimen properly. That means specimen data forms, letters, and other types of information that identify or describe the specimen for testing COVID-19 samples, acute respiratory disease, and also identify the shipper and receiver should be tapped into outside of the secondary receptacle. And next comes the processing of COVID specimens. If we want to do a blood CBC or complete hemogram, receive COVID sample in a Ziploc bag and the specimen should be in EDTA tube. Wear full PPE, that means gloves, gown and mask. Open the Ziploc inside a biosafety cabinet. If vacuum container is there, spray disinfectant outer surface with 70% alcohol or 0.5% hydrochloric. That means after receiving the blood sample, we should spray the disinfectant over that tube and wait for 30 minutes to allow the disinfectant. Now, handling of the hematology samples. Sample must be received after wearing full appropriate PPE. Sample must be closed. Do not open the cap and do not do smears. If it is necessary only, you have to prepare the peripheral smears. CBC with differential gown must be done. Okay, centrifuging of hematological samples shall not be done. then processing or handling of the biochemistry samples, that means cluttered sample. Wear proper PPE, keep the analyzer cup ready inside a safety cabinet. That means we have to separate the serum. So the biochemistry analyzing, we should separate the serum, and that serum we should put in the machine. That cup we should keep inside the safety cabinet. Take the sample immediately to the biosafety cabinet with packing intact. Open the sample inside a hood in an upright position. Wipe the outer surface with alcohol. As I told earlier, after receiving the sample, spray some disinfectant over the tube and allow for 30 minutes. Then wait for 30 minutes, load the serum into analyzer. If sample is uncluttered, centrifuge the sample. That means if while standing the sample, if it is serum is separated, then we can use directly. If otherwise, open the lid for open after 30 minutes, then centrifugation will generate aerosol. To avoid that, after centrifugation, wait for 30 minutes, then only open the lid of the centrifuge. Then separation of the serum. Centrifuge with biosafety cap. Allow to stand for 30 minutes. That serum gets separated. Centrifuge with full PPE. Avoid centrifugation, including QBC, as much as possible. Then prepare the sample into analyzer cup inside biosafety cabinet. Keep the sample inside the analyzer. Okay. Then remove your outer pair of gloves. Dispose that into the red bag. Generate request for the test run analyzer. That means if we are doing all this centrifugation all with the double glove, after putting the serum into the machine, we have to do we have to run the machine. For that, the outer glove we have to remove, because that outer glove may be contaminated with the infectious material. So we have to remove the outer glove. Then using that inner gloved hand, we load the sample, or we do command to the machine. After removing your outer pair of gloves, dispose into red bag, generate request for the test. Then wipe use the pipettes with alcohol immediately after use. That means for separation of serum and all, we might have used the pipettes. Immediately after use, wipe that with the bastard containing wipes. Then equipment disinfection and work area disinfection. Irrespective of all contaminant level, work surface and equipment must be decontaminated after specimen have been processed. That means if a positive COVID positive patient sample we have processed, then we have to clean that area. Use a disinfectant solution with proven activity against enveloped RNA viruses, including sodium hypochlorite, for general surface disinfection, and 1% for disinfection of blood spills, that I already told. Infectious materials to be disposed in a separate yellow bag labeled as COVID-19. That means every our PPE and if we dealing with the COVID positive samples, all that samples and the PPE should be labeled in a separate bag. That bag should be labeled as COVID-19 also. Okay, then handling of microbiology samples. That means except other than that swab, we might have using cultures and other things in the microbiology lab. Any other specimen for culture from COVID patient and all respiratory specimen, regardless of source, receive COVID sample with the Ziploc bag only. Wear full PPE, glove, gown and mask. Open the Ziploc inside the biosafety cabinet only. Disinfect the outer surface with 70% alcohol or 0.5% hypochlorite. And smear preparation plating must be carried out inside the biosafety cabinet if needed only. Then keep the plates, that means culture plates and all, inside a container or Ziploc bag. Disinfect the outer surface of the container or Ziploc bag and place into the incubator. Okay. Plate plating and all should carry out in the biosafety cabinet only. Process any investigation with the full PPE, ELISA, rapid test, PCR, RT-PCR, and any other investigation. It is for only COVID patients sample. convert the vacutainers with common care into 1% hypochlorite for 1 hour. That means the vacutainers should treat 1 hour in hypochlorite solution, then discard. Drain the treated blood specimen into drainage. Discard the empty pre-treated vacutainer into double layer drug bag and then to biomedical waste management collection center. This is all about the handling and safety precautions. Thank you. Thank you for all.
Hello, Dr. Shiga. Thank you.
Thank you. I think you people get something.
Yeah, it is we understood about the topic and it was a good presentation. I think maybe we obviously the attendance or participants may have the doubts. So it's open for a question and answer session. If anybody have doubts, you can unmute yourself or raise your hand by using the option which is given below the Zoom app, and you can ask the question also. Anybody have any doubt? You can unmute yourself.
ബ്ലീച്ചിങ് പൗഡർ ഹൈപ്പോക്ലോറിക്
ഹലോ പ്രബിഷ പ്രബിഷ മാഡം Do you have any doubt?
Yeah,
you can ask.
Shika, which are the viral transport media used for COVID-19?
Actually, that is commercially available. Okay. Viral transport media like that only we are receiving.
Name the media?
Name, I don't know. I am not working in the microbiology lab, so I don't know the exact name.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Prabisha madam. Anybody have any doubt or comments, please? Dr. Pradeep sir. Any doubt? Either you can raise your hand by using the option which is given below the Zoom app, or you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Mm-hmm. So expecting there is no more doubts or comments.
Hello, Prabisha.
Prabisha, you can tell Dr. Shiga.
WHO is recommending Eagles minimum essential media for viral transport.
Okay.
Thank you.
We can also prepare locally. As add 10 gram of VL infection dose and 2 gram of bovine albumin factor 5 to a sterile distilled water. That means 400 ml of distilled water, 10 gram of VL infusion, and add 0.8 ml of gentamicin sulfate solution and 3.2 ml of amphotericin B.
Hello. Okay, so I hope there is no more doubts or comments. Sir, we are moving on the...
Shabir sir, there is one more question in the chat box.
Okay. 1 minute. The question from Sachish Pattambadat. Is it possible to use BSc class 2 for handling the COVID-19 sample? Shiga madam, have you seen that question? Is it possible to use BSc class 2 for handling the COVID-19 sample? Hello, Dr. Shiga, can you hear me? Hello. Hello, Dr. Shiga. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Sir, I think there is some message from the speaker. Just check the message.
Yeah, I done that. Hello. Hello, Dr. Shiga, can you hear me? Hello, Shiga madam? Hello. Hello. I think she has facing some problem again. Okay, shall we wind up? I think if she is not able to communicate with us, maybe because of the technical problem, I feel better to conclude the session. Hello, Dr. Shiga, can you hear me? Hello. Okay, anyway, we are moving on to the wind up of, we are moving to wind up the session. Before that, I am inviting Mrs. Donske Sachi, BSc-MLT first year student, for delivering the vote of thanks officially. Donske Sachi.
Okay, sir. Hello, everyone. Myself, Donske Sachi, first year BSc MLT student of Lisi College of Allied Health Sciences. As we are approaching to the end of this section, I feel highly honored to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of Lisi College of Allied Health Sciences. Firstly, I would like to start by thanking Reverend Father Shanu Munyeli, Assistant Director, Lisi Hospital, for his inaugural address and sharing his thoughts on this occasion. Thank you, Father, for your blessed presence. I would also like to thank Reverend Father Paul Kareeran, Director of Lisi Hospital, and Reverend Father Jari Nyalyet, Assistant Director, Lissy Hospital and Medical Institutions, and the whole Lissy management for providing all the support for conducting this webinar. Next, I would like to thank Dr. Shigati, a well-known laboratory technologist and our distinguished speaker of the day, for her very much informative section on COVID-19, laboratory safety precautions and sample handling. Thank you, ma'am, for your wonderful section. Next, I thank our dearest principal, Dr. Shibir Sigbal, the mastermind behind the section, for managing and conducting a program like this through a digital platform and making it a huge success. Thank you, sir. I also like to thank all of our beloved teachers, non-teaching staff, and students of Lissy Medical and Educational Institutions, the IT department of Lissy, who made this meeting possible, and all other audience for their active participation throughout this meeting and making this a huge success. Once again, on behalf of Lissy College of Allied Health Science, I thank each and everyone who participated in this program, proving that even we are far apart from each other, we will defeat this deadly pandemic. Thank you, everyone. Stay home, stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you, Don. I think, Sajid sir, your question, Dr. Shiga has given the answer in chat box. I feel that the answer is satisfactory. So we are moving on to the winding up of the session. Today's session is over. Thank you all participants and dignitaries, and especially today's speaker, Dr. Shiga. Hope we can meet at the next session. Thank you. Thank you all.